Hello. Don't want to get in the way, have you? Come to interfere? Ah, well. We don't really mind, do we? No, we don't. When if I get on now? Good evening, Velocipedians. Oh, it's tinker time. Tinker time has been very scarce of lately, just because of domestic circumstances, really, care duties, etc. Very tying at the moment. So, the first thing I'm doing though is not cracking on with the maroon superb. Sorry, Chris. That's still sat in the work stand. First thing to do with that is get the wheels out and change the tyres. So that spurred me on to start this mammoth tyre changing escapade. I have the Courier here, as you can see, and I have the Courier's new tyres. Let me just show you properly what we're up against. See, we have definite wear and definite puncture vulnerability going on there when you compare it with a new tyre which has been run down the road. You can see what it should look like and what it does look like. So these are going on new Schealbe Delta Cruisers that I've had for a couple of years, but this bike of course is not your standard rally 3-speed. It's got drum brakes, so we have the Sturmey Archer X-FDD hub in the back, the modern Taiwanese version of a Sturmey Archer. So that has a brake anchor there for the drum brake in here, and then the cable just sits in the lever there. So I've got to pop those two off before I can pop off the cable on this side and detach at this side. Need to pull it all the way out because I need to pull the wheel nuts all the way off, because this bike has the carrier attached to the axle. So everything has to come off, everybody out of the pool. Notice it's got stainless steel nut there, which is 16mm rather than the usual 15. That was custom made for me 15 years ago, something like that. At the front we have dynamo on one side, simple plug to pull out, another drum brake on the other side, but this also has the same carrier fitting. This is a rear carrier that I cut down and it serves as a basket support nowadays. And then we have the reaction arm onto a P-clip there, so that has to be undone as well, of course. First thing to do is pop the homemade saddle cover on so I can flip it upside down. That's very simple, and there we are, and the dynamo wires come out themselves. pretty chuffed actually that I've done sufficient miles on this bike to wear out a set of tyres. Wearing out tyres is not something I do very often because I alternate bikes so much, but this one being a particular favourite for utilitarian use, I've gone through a set of Delta Cruisers. I don't know how many miles I've done, no idea. They're fairly robust tyres, but they're not necessarily the longest lasting tyres in the world. As you can see, they're sitting quite tight on these rims. I'm not very easily able to get them off with my fingers, but these are deep-sided alloy rims. Now then, it goes that away, so we need to be that away. Rim tape has moved slightly across the valve bolt. I've got Presta valves. I prefer Schrader valves in a utility bike, but these rims are drilled with a small hole for a Presta valve, so that's what it's got. I could drill the rims out a little bit. Really, it's not that important, certainly not important enough to do that. Push the valve up inside so that the tyre will seat down properly, because if it doesn't seat down properly by the valve, you ain't going to get it on at the other side. I could maybe use a bit of lube. To be honest, I'm nearly there. There we are. And pull the valve down a bit, get it nice and straight, and they can sit there until they're blown up. Next. Now these are tyres numbers 1 and 2 of, well, it's now 24. It was 20 at the end of my count up with the O, but they're now 24. A couple of other things I've decided to swap around. Bikes giving their tyres to other bikes and getting better ones. It took a long time. It did have about 70 psi in there. Run them quite hard because if it's a bike that gets loaded, and there is a video on the channel showing this bike grossly overloaded, just seeing how it rides and handles when it's loaded well beyond what it's supposed to be. And guess what, it of course was absolutely fine. Now, two pieces of suspicious material on there. I'm going to keep my hands away from. Bearing in mind this is a dog house and we are in the garden. It's quite firmly bedded in this deep rim. I've got it now. Again, minding the suspicious material, which is actually no longer suspicious. I can see perfectly well that it's dog poop. when I ran Bike Rescue, we were situated on the main riverside cycleway in York. Now, a little pause to concentrate. The wheel is going to be going that way, the tyre is going that way. So people used to bring their bikes in straight off the cycle track, and of course the cycle track is well used by walkers, or they'd just been through Roundtree Park or something like that. And we often had to tell people, can you take your bike outside and clean the tyres please before you bring it in? There's a hose pipe out there. It's very bad etiquette, isn't it, to bring a bike to a mechanic with dog shit all over the treads, to be honest. And I've just done it to myself. No self-respect. Quick visual of the rim tape as I go around. It seems to be fine. Push the rim in a bit further down there, slacken it off here, and then on it goes. Two new tyres, now back in the bike. Just spread the forks ever so slightly on this one. And now I've got the rack jammed in. The rack wants to join in before it's been invited. Of course, the bike wasn't designed for this 9mm axle, it was designed for the old small axle of your rally front hub. So this is a tight fit. It fits, but it's a tight fit. The dropouts were designed to take a dyno hub, which was a 3/8, I think it was, which is almost the same as 9mm. A squeeze. Put the retaining clip for the reaction arm. And get these wheel nuts on. The rack was designed for a rear, of course, so the legs are splayed out a little bit too far, which means they have to be pulled in quite a way on the threads for the narrower front dropout for which they were not designed. Check the centrality. Sounds like an Americanism, probably is. Still central, there we are. Noticed that my mud flap mountings are a little bit loose. Should have done that before I put the wheel back in. I'll quickly reach in and do it now. This, of course, is not standard. This is a Brooks mud flap. tight, Dad. Remedy. There we are, little squeeze on there. Push it further out. Should have done that before I did those bolts, but never mind. Now the cable sits in here. See, there's a groove in that part of the adjuster. That's it. And then this little barrel slides up over that pear nipple at the end and pops into there like that. And there we are. I have already tightened the clamp. Showing you how the dynamo wires connect. There we have two connectors, and the two wires go into this little grey top, and they fold over themselves quite simply, as long as they don't touch. And then there's this other piece which has to go over the connector, which is the difficult part to show you. There we are, got that on, and then the grey plug simply plugs into that, which seems to be a definite two-handed job. And now the back. The rookie error number one is when people forget to hook the chain over before sliding the wheel in. Now in this setup there are no anti-rotation washers to go inside, just outside. I've got one already on this side of the spindle, and a little tiny spread of the stays was required to drop the wheel in. Now I noticed before, you might have noticed as well, the chain was slightly slack. So this is our opportunity to get a good chain adjustment as well. Now we have the serrated washer that goes on here, followed by the carrier on both sides at the same time. It's just about impossible to do it one side at a time, the carrier, because it's so strong and rigid, it's not really flexible enough to fiddle one side on and then not the other. So it requires both sides together, which is a bit of a fiddle, but there we are, we've got it. Super duper stainless wheel nut number one. Check again, chain tension. Super duper stainless wheel nut number two. Thank you to my old pal Matt for making these for me years ago when he was a volunteer at Bike Rescue. and these are not 15mm, these are bigger, and I can't remember exactly what size. I've got an 11/16 here, is that the one?
No.
That was there for. There, 5/8, that's more like it. Yeah, 5/8 is alright. Keep checking that tension. Tighten the nut. Nice and tight. Check for centrality again. Tighten this side, nice and tight. Then we have two more things to do. Gear cable. Make sure that the shifter is in high gear, which releases all the tension off the cable. That's quite a wind in there, but that's fine. I could just slide this further along here if I needed more adjustment. That should be just about right there, I'd guess. Yeah, that's three gears engaged. Now, other side, and just connect the brake cable up, same as I did on the front. Well, that took about four times as long as I expected. I had all sorts of plans for this session today. All the different ones I was going to do. Got different tyres out and wheels ready. But this is all I managed to get done. At one point I made the fatal mistake of... Well, I broke my golden rule when working outside. Don't go near the house. As soon as you go near the house, that's it. You hear something like, "Ah, while you're here," and that's it, that's an hour gone. So, as you can see, we're at the end of the working day outdoors, and I'm going to go in after a little while and have a session inside, on starting on the green, on the maroon Superb, but I'm going to make this just a short video of its own on the Courier. And we'll carry on with the rest of the tyres in the next video, which I hope is going to be the massive tyre changing session all in one video. That would be lovely to get all that done. But today you get the Raleigh Courier. So not really anything for anybody to learn here apart from a little bit of insight on drum brake bikes, taking the wheels out of drum brake bikes. And of course the dyno hub as well. The Sturmey Archer, I just tested it, it's fine. It was adjusted bang on with my adjusting by feel. So I was quite chuffed with that. I did make a video about changing the shifter on this bike to this modern type of Sturmey Archer. And on that video I went into setting this up by eye. So, that's it for this video. We'll see you in a couple of days. It's not going to be as long a gap as you've just had, which is over a week, I think. This is going to be a couple of days, and I'll be back at you with more tinkering, or maybe even a ride, who knows. Thanks for watching then. Bye bye. Maybe I should give that white tail a pinch.